Bueno, muy buenas tardes a todos. Y cuando la demanda se hace presente, pues hay que atenderla, ¿cierto? Algunos de ustedes nos dijeron que les había parecido muy interesante lo que habíamos mostrado esta mañana, lo que el ministro había mostrado esta mañana, pero que pasamos un poco rápido y que querían saber un poquito más de lo que se había hecho. Algunos también me dijeron que no les gustaba la foto que le había aparecido ahí al frente. Y yo dije, pero esa es la foto que usted tenía en Facebook, ¿yo qué puedo hacer? Nosotros lo que hicimos sencillamente fue, con el apoyo de unos estudiantes de maestría de la Universidad de los Andes, tomar algo de la información que ustedes nos habían entregado y que nos habían autorizado a utilizar. En realidad, cuando nosotros hicimos el registro para este evento, ustedes nos dieron una información: el nombre, el número de la cédula, el teléfono, el sitio donde trabajaban. Posteriormente hicimos una actualización de esa hoja de registro y solicitamos un poquito más de información, que era sencillamente la cuenta de Twitter. Porque lo que queríamos hacer en realidad era un ejercicio de Big Data, pero involucrándolos a ustedes que estaban aquí presentes. Y queríamos mostrar parte de los resultados del ejercicio precisamente cuando estuvieron ustedes aquí al frente. Estos estudiantes, con el apoyo de una profesora, lo que hicieron fue empezar a imaginar qué podían hacer con la información que nosotros le entregamos. ¿Y qué le entregamos a ellos? Solamente la información pública. ¿Qué información? Su nombre y su cédula, única y exclusivamente. Porque ellos no necesitaban más información, porque esa información es pública. Aquí no tenemos un problema de privacidad, no tenemos un problema de protección de la información, no, porque esa es información pública. Nuestro nombre y nuestra cédula, nuestra identificación es pública bajo la legislación colombiana. Por lo tanto, estábamos utilizando información pública. ¿Para hacer qué? Para hacer búsqueda de información sobre la red, que también es pública. Toda aquella información que nosotros estamos publicando en las redes sociales se convierte en información pública, nos guste o no. Claro, en algunas de las soluciones que hay, existen algunos mecanismos para poder esconder un poco más la información, para evitar que otras personas tengan acceso a la información, para posibilitar que un grupo de amigos o de usuarios tengan acceso a esa información. Pero sencillamente el ejercicio que estábamos haciendo era un ejercicio que, desde la perspectiva de lo que es la analítica y el Big Data, es absolutamente válido. Nos cuidamos muchísimo, indiscutiblemente, de no infringir las reglas, la norma, ¿sí?, las leyes. Mal haríamos nosotros como ministerio infringiendo las leyes colombianas. Por lo tanto, en eso sí fuimos muy cuidadosos para hacer el ejercicio. Inicialmente nos planteamos un conjunto de preguntas. Dijimos, bueno, nos gustaría saber cuáles son los gustos en cuestión de deportes de las personas que están asistiendo a este evento. Nos gustaría saber qué tipo de comida les interesaría o les gusta a todas las personas que están participando en ese evento. Pero desafortunadamente, para poder encontrar esa información, necesitamos algo más de datos de parte de ustedes. La cuenta Twitter, que en ese momento no la teníamos, ¿sí? Por lo tanto, sencillamente nos limitamos a ver qué podíamos hacer con la creatividad de estos estudiantes para que, con la cédula y el nombre, pudiéramos entregarles algo de información a ustedes que estaban aquí presentes. Queríamos era mostrarles la realidad de ustedes mismos, pero a través de un ejercicio de analítica de datos, a través de un ejercicio de cruce de información, a través del ejercicio de acceso a la información que ustedes mismos han publicado en las diferentes redes. Y este fue precisamente el resultado de ese ejercicio. Un conjunto de fotos que son ustedes, posiblemente se identifican, posiblemente si miran al lado derecho, ahí está la persona, posiblemente si miran al lado izquierdo, ahí está la persona. Pero son las fotos de las personas que están asistiendo a este evento, o algunas de las personas. Hicimos el muestreo con 1.400 nombres y cédulas, que era lo que teníamos en el momento de corte, el miércoles de la semana pasada. Y vimos también que hay, además de fotos, pues hay algunos logos de empresas, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. Y los algoritmos, toda la algorítmica que estos estudiantes de maestría definieron o diseñaron, nos permitió empezar a encontrar algo de información. Información como, por ejemplo, el nivel de incidencia que tienen en las redes sociales. ¿Y eso cómo lo estamos mostrando? Lo mostramos a través del tamaño del icono que aparece en esta gráfica. Y si nosotros vamos moviendo el cursor por encima de este diagrama, pues lo que nos está apareciendo es la información de la persona, ¿sí?, que está detrás de esa foto. Alex Sanabria Niño es publicista con experiencia en marketing y docencia universitaria, cambiando de piel analógica a digital, director de mercadeo, canal digital y mayorista HP. El lugar, los amigos 1157 y los seguidores 1255. Y fíjense que esa información nunca se la preguntamos a nadie. Ninguna de esta información le preguntamos a ustedes, le preguntamos posiblemente a la empresa, les preguntamos posiblemente el cargo, ¿sí? Pero ese nivel de detalle de información en realidad nunca se lo preguntamos a ustedes. Es a través del ejercicio de los algoritmos que nosotros fuimos descubriendo, o que los estudiantes fueron descubriendo toda esta información y la fueron organizando. Y la organizaron de una forma que visualmente es atractiva además. Entonces, en temas de Big Data también es importante los aspectos de visualización. Visualizar la información también es importante desde la perspectiva de lo que es la presentación y la apropiación de la información. Y aprovechando entonces la coyuntura que teníamos en Colombia de las elecciones, también se indagó algo con respecto a la parte de las votaciones. En esa indagación y teniendo también fuentes públicas de información, empezamos a buscar información, o empezaron a buscar información frente a dónde las personas que iban a asistir a este evento y que hoy en día están sentadas, tenían registrada su cédula, por lo tanto, iban a votar. Y este fue el mapa entonces que se creó con algunos de los datos que nosotros tenemos allí. Los punticos rojos representan a las personas, a los votantes, y los punticos verdes representan a aquellos que fueron jurados de votación. O sea, a algunos de ustedes, no a todos, les tocó ser jurado. Afortunadamente, dice uno le tocó, pero tuvo la fortuna realmente de ser jurado y a seguir agregándole hasta... Bajar un poquito. No, para el otro lado, déjame ver el mapa un segundo. Vemos aquí en esta visualización cómo a medida que movemos el cursor sobre las zonas de Bogotá, pues aparece la identificación de la zona de Bogotá. Y si nosotros nos paramos sobre algunos de los puntos, vamos a encontrar la información de las personas. David Antonio Rendón Rodríguez, que tiene esa cédula, género masculino, régimen de salud, salud contributivo, tipo de afiliado, cotizante federal, y además encontramos cuál era su EPS. Entonces tenemos aquí información en un mapa de el sitio donde prefirió votar, que muy seguramente se acerca a la zona donde puede llegar a vivir. Podríamos seguir indagando hasta encontrar información de la ubicación como tal. Pero lo que queremos mostrar acá es que con el solo nombre y la cédula, ¿sí?, y la información que es información pública, que es de la parte del registro para poder votar, pudimos empezar a construir este tipo de información o este tipo de mapas. ¿Qué información entonces empezamos a construir? Empezamos a construir información de las edades de las personas que iban a participar en este evento. Menores de 25 son el 13.1%, mayores de 45 el 11.4%, o sea, somos los de menor participación. Entre los 25 y los 35 años tenemos un 44.2% y entre los 36 y los 45 un 31.3%. Fíjense que entonces la concentración principal de los asistentes a este evento está entre los 25 y los 45. Y esa es la zona donde realmente estamos aprendiendo los temas de Big Data. Es la zona en la cual tenemos que tener claridad en esas definiciones que nos hablaba esta mañana Andrés Contreras frente a lo que es Big Data y para qué sirve. ¿Sí? Aquí están los tomadores de decisiones de las organizaciones, pero aquí están también aquellos jóvenes que están impulsando a las organizaciones a modernizarse y a ser atrevidas y a hacer innovaciones. Entonces, ese es el segmento que está poblando los participantes en este evento. De ellos, el 8.8% fue jurado de votación y el 91.2% no fue jurado de votación. Y esta forma de describir la información, de representar la información, tiene también otra característica. Y es que cuando yo estoy en la leyenda de la torta, de lo que estoy describiendo, y no quiero esconder un dato, sencillamente lo que hago es, lo señalo, hago clic sobre ello, José, por favor, hago clic sobre ello, y lo que estoy haciendo entonces es escondiendo una variable que en ese momento me parece relevante esconderla. ¿Esconderla para qué? Para hacer un análisis de otro tipo. Quitemos, por ejemplo, los de 25 años, los menores de 25 años y los mayores de 45, José, a ver cómo nos da. Y nos da que aquí hay una distribución muy pareja y los mayores de 45 también. Eso. Listo. Nos da una distribución relativamente pareja, pero definitivamente los más jóvenes, ¿sí?, son los que estuvieron más interesados en participar en este evento. ¿Y por qué? Porque es que ellos son los que están viéndole más potencial, porque son ellos los que quieren ser los nuevos emprendedores, porque son ellos los que quieren estar en esa nueva economía, porque son ellos los que quieren dominar definitivamente esa economía digital y apropiarse de ella y generar empleo, generar empresa, generar riqueza. También vimos de dónde procedían. Claro, esto es un evento que se está desarrollando en Bogotá. De una forma natural, la mayor cantidad de inscripciones pues venían de Bogotá. Es mucho más fácil cuando estamos aquí en esta ciudad pues participar en el evento cuando se desarrolla en la ciudad. Entonces, obviamente hay un 68.5% que pesa muchísimo dentro de la distribución de donde del origen de las personas que asisten a este evento. ¿De dónde sacamos el origen de las personas? De la información que ustedes nos dieron, de la cédula. Nosotros nunca le preguntamos de dónde expidieron la cédula, ¿cierto? Pero eso es información pública. Por lo tanto, es número de la cédula a través de unas consultas a fuentes de información que son públicas, podemos obtener dónde se expidió la cédula. Y al saber dónde se expidió la cédula, inferimos el origen de la persona. No necesariamente quiere decir el sitio donde nació, pero sí por lo menos el sitio donde expidió la cédula, o sea, por donde cuando fue mayor de edad se expidió. Si quieres, escondamos a Bogotá, José, que es el rojito. A ver cómo nos da el resto de la distribución. No, en el mismo de arriba, José. Esconder, no, te pasaste. Bueno, ya les quedo debiendo la distribución por el otro lado. El mapa, salud, José, ¿dónde dice salud? La torta de origen, escóndeme Bogotá DC. O sea, selecciona en la leyenda Bogotá DC. Abajo en la leyenda, abajo. Eso, ahí, más abajo, ¡ey! Eso, sí, listo. Escóndeme ese a ver para ver cómo, hazle clic. Al Valle, no, ¿qué tiene contra los del Valle? No, Bogotá. Entonces, si nosotros eliminamos la variable que en este momento está pesando más dentro de la distribución, al hacer esta selección, pues sencillamente vemos a nivel de procedencia otra distribución que también es importante. Entonces, ese tipo de herramientas de visualización para hacer el tratamiento de los datos es importante cuando estamos tomando decisiones. Esa variable de Bogotá entonces pesaba mucho dentro del análisis que queríamos hacer, se llevaba, arrastraba los datos, no era representativo para el análisis que queríamos hacer, era qué tanto impacto habíamos tenido en convocar personas de otras partes del país. ¿Sí? Y entonces aquí podemos ver que tuvimos un impacto interesante en, por ejemplo, Cundinamarca, ¿sí?, que tiene el 20.7%. Posiblemente las personas hoy en día están viviendo ya aquí en Bogotá. ¿Cómo logramos obtener esa información si la queremos profundizar? Acuérdense que tenemos el lugar de votación, ¿sí? Al tener el lugar de votación de las personas, podemos sencillamente ver si en realidad este porcentaje de 20.7% de las personas de Cundinamarca que vinieron, que se registraron a este evento, ya residen en Bogotá o no residen, o qué porcentaje de esa parte reside en Bogotá. Esa es la parte de analítica de datos que nos interesa poder hacer cuando estamos trabajando en materia de Big Data. Necesitamos los datos, necesitamos analizar los datos, necesitamos cruzar información, necesitamos trabajar con ese conjunto de información para poder tomar decisiones inteligentes. Si quieres, bájate a ese. Y también aquí existe una información sobre la formación de las personas que se inscribieron o que se registraron a este evento. La mayoría de las personas que están registradas en este evento son graduados de las disciplinas de ingeniería, ingeniería de sistemas, ingeniería electrónica, civil, multimedia, etcétera, etcétera. Y tenemos técnicos, tenemos estudiantes, tenemos analistas, tenemos personas de ciencias sociales, tenemos personas de medicina, de administración, de diseño, de ciencias, docentes, tenemos desarrolladores de software. Entonces, aquí también podemos ver cuál es la población de las personas que se inscribieron para participar en este evento. Todo eso con la poca información que nosotros les preguntamos a ustedes en el momento de registrarse. Entonces, a partir de esa poca información, pero utilizando la algorítmica, haciéndose las preguntas que uno quiera hacer y toda la información que todos y cada uno de ustedes publican y que además publican otros entes, sean estos privados o sean entes públicos, fue que se pudo construir esta información que les presentamos el día de hoy. Las personas que trabajaron en esta presentación y en toda la estructuración de este dato es Andrea Carolina Buitrago, Camilo Restrepo Arango y Leslie Evelyn Solórzano. Son estudiantes, asistentes graduados de la Universidad de los Andes, estudiantes de la Maestría de Ingeniería de Sistemas y Computación, y ellos, voluntariamente, cuando nosotros lanzamos una idea, y es qué hacemos con, cómo hacemos para tener una vivencia de las personas que estén participando en el evento, ellos mismos se sentaron a pensar y se sentaron a construir todo aquello que les acabo de mostrar. Para mí, mucho agradecimiento a estas tres personas y obviamente a la profesora que estaba también trabajando con ellos, orientándoles un poco para que pudiéramos mostrarles a ustedes algo de ustedes mismos. Y es información que ustedes nos entregaron, información que está pública, construimos, analizamos y generamos esto. Eso era todo lo que quería mostrarles a ustedes, profundizar un poco más de lo que mostramos esta mañana y muchísimas gracias por venir a este evento.
Gracias, doctor Hugo Cintriana, director de la iniciativa I+D+I del Ministerio de las Tecnologías. Vamos a hacer un ajuste en la agenda y vamos a invitar para que nos acompañe en este momento para hablar de Monetizing Big Data, es decir, todo lo que tiene que ver con el sector financiero. Nos acompaña en este momento entonces el señor Patrick Schwerfeger, especialista en Big Data e Inteligencia de Negocios, quien está aquí con nosotros en Colombia. Vamos a recibirlo, por favor. Él ya está listo para iniciar su presentación. Un aplauso para él, son tan amables.
Thank you. Thank you. Buenos días. That may be the extent of my Spanish. I grew up in Canada, so I learned French and some German and, of course, English. But I don't know much Spanish. Thank you so much for being here and for inviting me to contribute. Today we're going to take a broader look. We've had a lot of different sessions so far looking at some very detailed information and some very detailed case histories. But what this session is about is to take a larger look at where's the money? How do you actually monetize big data? Where does the return on investment actually come from with big data? And the reality is that the ROI has been slow to pick up. A lot of people are investing in big data initiatives and are not necessarily making a lot of profit yet, but it's growing. And so we're going to take a look at some of those case histories in this session today. I'd like to begin with this story here. I wonder how many of you here might recognize, oh, that went ahead of me, these two gentlemen here. We'll start with the guy on the left. His name is Brian Acton, and Brian Acton graduated from university in 2009 and began applying for jobs. One of the places that he applied was Facebook, and Facebook turned him down. So he wrote a tweet about it at the time on Twitter. Here's what he said. He said, "Facebook turned me down. It was a great opportunity to connect with some fantastic people. Looking forward to life's next adventure." And what might that be? Well, he got together with a friend of his and started WhatsApp, which he built and grew over the course of 5 years and sold to none other than Facebook for a cool $19 billion. So there's some irony there, some poetic justice perhaps. But there was a lot of people who looked at this transaction at the time and tried to explain why Facebook paid so much for WhatsApp. And so there's a few different ways to look at this transaction. One is that at the time of the sale, they had 55 employees. So by that measure, Facebook paid an average of $345 million per employee. Incredible. Another way to look at it is that at the time of the sale, the platform had 450 active monthly users. So by that measure, Facebook paid $42 per user. But regardless how you look at a transaction like this, when $19 billion changes hands, it's an awful lot of money. Maybe the most interesting angle to look at this is that over the course of just 5 years, 55 employees managed to engage over 450 million active monthly users. And that speaks really to the leverage that's in our economy today. It speaks to the leverage that's in this technology that we're here, that we're learning about in this conference. There's enormous leverage in technology, and people and businesses are taking advantage of that leverage. So when you hear these stories on the internet or on the evening news, there's an increasing number of stories about the division between rich and poor. What they're really referring to is this leverage. Some people, some businesses are learning to capitalize on this leverage, while a lot of people, frankly, are being leveraged by the same trends. So how do we take advantage of the leverage? There's leverage everywhere. Indeed, software is a form of leverage, right? You can leverage software in your business. The cloud is a form of leverage. You can leverage the cloud, right? Which is an enabling technology of big data. Mobile technology, you can leverage mobile technology, as we've seen just two sessions ago. Fantastic use case of using mobile data. And of course, robotics. You can leverage robotics. Robotics is exploding these days. If you've been keeping up on it, there are more and more types of robots which are able to be used in businesses. In fact, this here is the Tesla factory in Fremont, California. This is just a few miles from where I live. This entire factory is robotic. And in fact, that's the only way that you could manufacture automobiles in California is if you leverage robotics. This factory employs almost no employees. In fact, here's one of them right there. But aside from just a handful of people, there's almost no employees in this factory. Here's another view of that same factory. It's astonishing. And this here is a distribution center for Amazon. And all of these different shelving units are navigated around the warehouse by these robotic navigation devices that pick up the shelving units and bring them to the people at the front of the factory. Oh, this keeps going one ahead. That bring them to the people in the factory to pick, pack, and ship whatever it is that's being ordered. So I love quotes. I'm someone who literally buys books of quotes. This is one of my favorite quotes. The future is already here. It just isn't evenly distributed yet. We don't have to reinvent the wheel with these technologies. There are companies already using all of these technologies. We just have to look in the right places, which is what we're going to do in this session, to find out how people are leveraging the technologies that we're talking about today. Of course, big data is just one more form of leverage that we can take advantage of. So the reason Facebook paid $19 billion for WhatsApp, it was a data play. They were looking for the data, not only the data that's available at the time of the transaction, but the data that's going to be available in the future as a result of having access to this platform. There's value in the data. People are increasingly finding value in the data. So we've all seen, as you saw just a second ago here, a graph that looks something like this, where you have the innovators on the left-hand side, early adopters, early majority, late majority, and the laggards. The truth is that with big data, we're just getting started. I know that it seems in a conference like this, where everyone in this room is focused on big data and is learning the technologies and is finding ways to implement it, that in fact, everybody's already doing this, but it's not true. Most people are not doing this effectively yet. We're just getting started. And that means there's an opportunity. In fact, I have some statistics I'll show you in just a short while that show exactly how much we are still at the cutting edge of this technology. People are still trying to figure it out. So I want to take, as I said at the beginning, a broader look at some of the technologies that are they're transforming our entire economy in America, where I'm from, and across the entire world. Because we are living in exponential times. Technology advances along an exponential curve. Most things historically advanced along a linear curve. technology is different. It advances along an exponential curve. So just to give you an idea, mobile, of course, is generating a huge amount of data. Satellites that are going around the Earth are taking measurements 24 hours a day. They're generating a huge amount of data. We have RFID tags on many of the products that we purchase. We have sensors on any buildings that we're in. Of course, this is what we people talk about when they refer to the Internet of Things. Right, we have smart meters on the outside of our homes. We have smart thermostats on the inside of our homes. We use smart televisions. We use smart appliances. There's more sensors all the time. In fact, there's on ships like these, every one of these containers has sensors today, measuring a variety of different things, and even cattle. Cows. In the United States, I don't know if you know this, but at any given point in time, there's roughly 90 million cows in the United States. And many of these cows, an increasing percentage of these cattle, are being outfitted with sensors that are attached to a 3G mobile network because it's measuring the temperature to see if those cows have a fever. So if one of them gets sick, you can take them out from the herd before it gets any of the other cows sick. This is where this is going. This is what the Internet of Things, they call it the IoT, this is what it's all about. Some people refer to it as M2M. But by 2020, they're estimating that there's going to be over 50 billion devices measuring various things and communicating with internal servers over the Internet. That's the Internet of Things. The total amount of data being captured and stored by businesses and industry doubles every 1.2 years right now. That's an exponential trend. We're seeing it right now. It's happening right now. And just to give you an idea of the scale, the stock market is a facility that historically has been an example of an industry that generates an enormous amount of data. Well, the truth is that the stock market generates about 1 terabyte of data per day. By comparison, Facebook generates 30 terabytes of data each day, 30 times as much as the stock market. And an Airbus A380 generates 30 terabytes of data per engine every 30 minutes. They have sensors. These are Rolls-Royce engines. They have 4 Rolls-Royce engines. They have sensors throughout these engines to look for ways to optimize the way the engine is working. They measure airspeed, temperature, pressure, everything you can imagine, because they're looking for ways to optimize the performance. You'll see in just one moment that optimization is one of 3 primary financial opportunities of big data. We'll get to it in just a second. But it gives you an idea of the scale of what's happening, because if they can increase fuel efficiency by 1%, it adds $20 billion to their bottom line. That's where the money is. If they can increase the efficiency of their engines by 1%, it works out to $2 billion. It's an enormous amount of money. So that's what this exponential trend really is. And I want to cover one more aspect of this, because it's important that we see the different. These trends are all converging. They're all coming together. So let's take a look. There's really 3 areas that are following this exponential curve. One is data processing. That's the first one. The second is data bandwidth. And the third one is data storage. All 3 of these are following an exponential curve. So you've got data processing, data bandwidth, and data storage. So what would happen if they were free? As a company, think about your company. Think about the business that you're a part of, or the government department. What would they do? What would you do if data processing, bandwidth, and storage were free? Of course, they're never going to be completely free, but I'll show you how close it gets. This is an astonishing statistic. If you look back in 2010, what was the cost of storing 1 petabyte of data? So just for anyone who's just a review, 1,000 kilobytes is a megabyte, 1,000 megabytes, right? Keeps going up, gigabyte, terabyte, and then a petabyte. So to store 1 petabyte of data in 2010 cost $80,000. By 2020, 10 years later, just 5 years from now, they're projecting that the cost to store 1 petabyte of data
Think about what you think might this number might be. What would it cost in 2020? The real number is that just 5 years from now, they're projecting the cost to store 1 petabyte of data to be $4. What would you do if data processing bandwidth and storage were free? Or what would your competitors do if data processing bandwidth and storage were free? Guys, this is coming. This is coming. It's already preordained. This is coming our way. The costs are plummeting. And when the costs plummet in 5 or 10 years from now, everybody is going to be in the data business. And there's countless businesses, as you already know, that are trying to provide that data and those insights and those visualizations in ever more cost-effective ways for businesses like yours to take advantage of. This is coming. It's all coming our way. And we're just getting started right now. Because when those costs come down as much as they're going to, everybody, businesses that you would never expect, are going to be getting into the data business and analyzing the data that they have and purchasing the data that they need. So where's the opportunity? I said before, there's three primary opportunities for return on investment of big data. The first one is security, which generally equates to fewer disasters. The second is optimization, which generally equates to lower expenses, lower costs. And finally, the third one is prediction, which generally equates to higher revenue. These aren't exclusive, there's exceptions, but for the most part, security is fewer disasters, optimization is lower costs, and prediction is higher revenue. So there's a lot of data-driven startups, of course, that are leveraging the capabilities of data today. For example, Zillow is a perfect example of a data-driven startup. Uber, whether you like Uber or hate Uber, is certainly a data-driven startup. Fitbit, I'm sure there's people in this audience that are wearing Fitbits, that's a data-driven startup. 23andMe is another good example. But what about traditional businesses? Because that's what most of you are probably a part of, traditional businesses, traditional organizations, where you have an existing business model and we're putting a layer of data analytics on top of it. Right? For those startups, data is their business. They provide data and they sell data. That's their entire business model. But for most of you, you have a different business model where you're doing different things, selling products and services, but now we're putting a layer of data on top of it. So what are the industries today that are really taking advantage of big data? Well, of course, you already know, but I'll go through these quickly. Number one, the banking industry and insurance in particular, as you heard earlier this morning, excellent use cases and a lot of, they're using optimization, right, to minimize risk in their portfolios for the most part. That's a huge part of what they're doing. You have Medicare, healthcare, where they're using data like crazy on an increasing basis. And it's not just the public organizations, but in my country, in America, large companies like Walmart are opening up health clinics, and they're using data far more so far than the larger insurance providers. Telecom, of course, is a huge user of data today. Smart cities, probably the best example of smart cities right now is Singapore. It's an excellent example. In fact, Rio de Janeiro in Brazil is doing a remarkable job as well in the smart city space. It's astonishing the number of things you can do, in fact. In Singapore, they have sensors on all of their major thoroughfares, their major roads. And so they charge tolls for using the roads, and the more people who are on those roads, the higher the toll is. And so, of course, people want to avoid those higher tolls, and so they're driving in different times, which reduces the number of cars on the road, it reduces the traffic congestion, and it's actually reduced the average commute time 25%. The average commute is down in Singapore as a result of their use of sensors and big data analytics. And of course, when the average commute is 25% lower, that means that the cars are on the road 25% less, which means the pollution drops by 25% as well. So really fascinating implications. It's not just quality of life, it's pollution, productivity, and the economy as a whole that are all being impacted by some of these big data initiatives. Another big area is e-government. I know you've heard about that as well. This is the the effort of governments around the world to provide their services over the internet. In fact, there are some countries where you can literally pay your taxes by SMS on your mobile phone. And the United Nations actually does a survey every 2 years of all the different countries around the world and where they are in terms of their progress in e-governance. And if you're curious who those countries are, here's the top 10. Not surprisingly, it's South Korea is top of the list. Australia is very high. You can see some of the other nations. It seems like the Asia-Pacific region and Northern Europe are really leading the charge, but there's a remarkable amount of progress being made here in this neck of the woods as well, and you can see where Colombia is relative to Chile and Argentina and Brazil as well. Fascinating uses of big data. Of course, the intelligence communities, not just American, but around the world, are indeed using big data as well. And the last one, which I want to point out, is what they refer to as the four horsemen. If you want to follow what's happening in technology, just follow these four companies. And many of them actually publish what they're doing. In fact, Google publishes white papers on a regular basis in terms of their development and their advances in big data technologies and their use of Hadoop and a variety of other technologies. You can find those white papers. I've downloaded them myself. I learn from reading some of their literature, and they're constantly putting more literature out there. I encourage you to take a look at that literature yourself. So let's take a look at some success stories. And these are use cases. You've heard some use cases already today, and some of you have heard some of these stories, but there's going to be a few, I think, that you probably haven't heard before. But the important thing is that they fall into one of two camps. They either reduce costs or they increase revenue. So we'll go through each one, but those are the examples of where people are finding return on investment for their initiatives. They're either reducing costs or increasing revenue. So let's get started. You may have heard of this one. It's one of the best known in the space. There was an angry father who went into a Target store in Minneapolis, Minnesota, in the United States. He's very upset, as the story goes. He got his store manager and pulled him aside and said, "This is crazy. My 17-year-old daughter is getting coupons in the mail from Target for baby food and diapers." This thing keeps jumping ahead on me. Oh, it's dead. Can I get a new clicker? One up. Oh, now it's working. Thank you. So if it doesn't work again, I may have to switch it out. So she's getting coupons in the mail for diapers and baby food. The father was furious. Is Target suggesting that his 17-year-old daughter should be getting pregnant and having babies at this time? So anyway, the store manager apologized profusely and said, "Look, we'll get her off the list." And he actually went so far as to call the father 3 days later and just apologize again and say, "Look, I just wanted to confirm that your daughter's been taken off that list. We really apologize for any inconvenience." And the father said on the phone, which I give him credit for, he said, "You know, I actually owe you an apology," which is amazing, "because as a result of this whole fiasco, we've had some conversations in our house, and it turns out there's been some things happening that we weren't aware of, and my daughter is due in August." So Target knows she's pregnant before her father knows she's pregnant. Privacy is dead. Because finding the data is too easy. You can triangulate using other data to find out what's going on anyway. But again, let's think about what actually happened here. You see, there's only a few times in a person's life where your shopping habits dramatically change. Okay? One of the times that happens is when you have a baby. Isn't this a great picture? This is not my child. And of course, when you have a child, it's a matter of public record, right? So most of you have children. As soon as you have children, you immediately start getting coupons in the mail because it's a matter of public record. It's very easy for a business to find out when someone's had a baby. But Target wanted to find out before the baby arrived. That's not a matter of public record. So how do you do that? Well, you find the people who had a baby, That's a matter of public record. And then you go back 9 months and see how their shopping habits changed to see if you can try and figure out if they're pregnant or not. Right? What were the telltale signs that showed Target that someone's pregnant? Well, of course, there's a lot of, I'm sure you're thinking of different ideas right now. Turns out the answer is prenatal vitamins and scent-free soap. So if you're buying prenatal vitamins and scent-free soap, there's a very good chance that you're in your second trimester of pregnancy. That's what they found. And they started working with that to get ahead of the curve. Right? So we have companies like Netflix that know what movies you'll like before your friends know what movies you'll like. And we have Pandora that knows what songs you'll like before you know what songs you'll like. This is all called predictive analytics, right? We all know this. It's predictive analytics. And it's a process of taking a large population and subdividing it into different groups based on other behavioral characteristics so you can target each subgroup individually. So when you go to a website like Amazon, they show you the things that you might be interested in based on your past behavior, right? We all know these things. And it's actually, they take these things to a far degree. This is about politics in the United States. And I grew up in Canada. I think the politics in the United States is like a circus show. It's crazy over there. But you basically have two parties. You have the Democrats, which is the party that Barack Obama is from, and you have the Republicans, which is the party that George Bush is from. So it turns out that if you visit one of these three websites, or any of these three websites for that matter, there's a very high probability that you're either a Democrat or a Republican. Which one do you think? Democrat, the party that Barack Obama is from. So what about Republicans? What websites do they go to? Guys, I did not make this up. They go to eBay, Bing, and Farmville. It's a lot of different ways to use the data, to understand your customer, to create a larger profile of who is your target market, who is most likely to purchase. You can find out so many different things about those people. New York City had a problem because their manhole covers, where there's cables and things and sewage underneath, in many cases they were having fires underneath these manhole covers, and in some cases they would explode and the manhole cover would fly in the air, cause damage. In some cases some people were even hurt quite badly as a result of this. So they wanted to reduce these fires, and so they brought on a team from MIT to look at the data, and their data included 52,000 manholes in the greater New York City area, 23,000 miles of cable, that's just shy of 40,000 kilometers of cable, 61,000 trouble tickets, and 126 years of maintenance records. But the bottom line, and the culprit was fairly easy to pick. We just had to do the calculation to figure out which ones were at risk. The biggest risk factor was old wiring. But as a result of doing the analysis, they were able to reduce the fires by 80%. By 80%. Right? This is predictive maintenance. It's one of the biggest areas of big data today. It's happening in factories with factory machines and robots. It's happening with trucks, fleets of cars, airplanes, trains. Predictive maintenance is a huge opportunity in big data. The bottom line is data can reduce expenses. That's number one. We're going to do one more, and then we'll go to a closing. Okay? But it can reduce expenses. How can data reduce your expenses? Right? What are the areas where you can employ these strategies? We've only got a short time together. So think about how do you apply this for the initiatives that you're working on yourself? Walmart. That's a great story. Some of you may have heard this one too. Walmart did correlation analysis on their sales and weather patterns outside to see how weather patterns affected sales. And in particular, they looked at hurricanes. Because hurricanes, you got 6 or 7 days notice, right? Which is an enormous advantage. If you've got 6 or 7 days, you have enough time to respond to it. So what products go up in sales when a hurricane's coming? Well, again, I'm sure you've got a lot of different ideas of the products that generally go up in sales. These are the the usual suspects here. Let me see if I can get this to go. There it goes. These are the usual suspects, products that normally go up in sales. But it turns out that there was a few products that they didn't expect at all. And one in particular that goes up consistently over 600% when a hurricane is coming. What product is that? Strawberry Pop-Tarts. Strawberry Pop-Tarts consistently go up in sales when a hurricane's coming. And the instinct when you hear a statistic like this is to think, why does that happen? Who cares? Who cares? Right? We are human beings. We are not rational creatures all the time. Many times we do things that are not rational. So who cares why they buy strawberry Pop-Tarts? The fact is that they do. And so if a hurricane is coming, you've got enough time to stock the shelves with strawberry Pop-Tarts and make sales that you would not have made otherwise. That's what the data is all about. And this is one of the biggest lessons, learning points of big data in general, is that you can't go into the data with a hunch of what you're looking to find. Let the data speak for itself. Let the data speak for itself. Sorry about that, guys. Sometimes you're going to find things that come out of the data that you don't expect, and that's okay. That's okay. The bottom line is we have to look at the data to find out in the first place, and that's exactly what Walmart did. There's actually another great case history. Canadian Tire, I was born, as I mentioned, in Canada. Moved to the United States when I was 27, by the way. I'm 44 today, so I didn't grow up with this stuff. This is all new to me as I got a little bit older myself. But Canadian Tire is a very large retailer in Canada, and they took a look at determining people's credit scores based on their purchase activity. And again, this is their data, not mine, but they came to the conclusion, for better or for worse, that if you spend a lot of time in pool halls playing billiards, you probably have a fairly low credit score on average. So what was it? What were the things that were telltale signs of people who had high credit scores? Well, if you buy premium bird food, you've got a high credit score. If you have felt pads on your furniture, you probably have a very high credit score. And if you have a carbon monoxide filter in your home, you definitely have a high credit score. So you can think to yourself, how many people here have felt pads on your furniture at home? And I can tell you that I do, right? And now think about your credit score. It's a very high likelihood that if you have felt pads on your furniture. The point is, you can learn about people. You don't need to check the credit. Once you've done the correlation and you know the correlation is there, you don't need the credit rating agency anymore. You can determine the same thing just by watching buying activity. Right, you can find the data in so many different places. And this here is, it's almost scary a little bit. But Harrah's, the casino company Harrah's, which of course has casinos everywhere, this one here is Vegas, they wanted to find out people's gambling pain point. So listen to this for a second. Everybody has a point at which they've lost so much money that they're so disgusted that they never come back. That's bad news for the casinos. They want you to lose money, but they don't want you to lose so much that you never come back. And it's a different level for everybody. So for some people, it might be $400. For some people, it might be $10,000. Everyone's got a different pain point. Harrah's goes to great lengths to try and calculate a pain point for every one of their regular visitors. And then they monitor those people gambling in their own casino in real time to see if anyone's getting close to their pain point. And if they're getting close, they send someone on the floor to give them a coupon for a free meal and get them off the floor. They want those people off the floor before they reach their pain point. They want you to lose money just enough that you're still okay and you'll come back and lose more tomorrow. It's pretty scary. These things are pretty scary. But data can increase revenue. That's the second part. Data can increase revenue. Data can reduce expenses and data can increase revenue. We're just getting started. Guys, there's so much opportunity to do this. There's so many different places where you can find insights and adjust your business accordingly. We are at the dawn of a new generation of business systems. It's a quote from the CEO of Microsoft. It's true. Things are changing very, very quickly right now along an exponential curve. Do you know what that means? People don't often realize $80,000 down to $4 in just 10 years. Things are going to change dramatically. They're already changing dramatically, but it's going to get faster. So what my message for you today is to think bigger, right? Not just a little bit bigger, but way bigger about what's possible. Think about your business and the role that it can play, not just in the Bogota market or the Colombian market or the South American market, but on the world stage. What could you do? Because there's actually some very fascinating research. When you think bigger, when you embrace ambitious goals, there's some really interesting research on how that affects performance, right? And people's and your employees' satisfaction level and turnover. When you have ambitious goals, it actually reduces turnover. In fact, when you think bigger, there's really three things that normally happen. Number one, your life's just a lot more exciting, which actually does increase performance, and it does reduce turnover. Both of those are true. Number two, you end up inspiring everyone else around you, including your employees, including your suppliers, including your competitors, including your customers, including your friends and family. When you do something big, everyone gets inspired by that. And again, if you think bigger, and I mean this when I say this, I'm not talking a little bit bigger, I'm talking about way bigger. When you think way bigger, you quite often have almost no competition along the way because everyone else is too busy chasing realistic goals. Forget realistic goals. I mean, don't stop them entirely, but add a few big ones to the mix. Do something big. What's the big thing that you can do? There's a few people who are just poster children for this kind of thing. Richard Branson is a great example. He actually has a quote that I told you I love quotes, and he has a quote that is one of my favorite quotes. He said, "The fastest way to become a millionaire is to start out as a billionaire and then start an airline." But he thinks big, right? He's the one who started Virgin Galactic. I mean, how much bigger are you going to be than that? Any competition? Nope. What about Elon Musk? You guys know him? He's the guy who started SpaceX. He's a company that's literally revolutionizing rocket technology. They're actually re-landing rockets that have gone up and trying to re-land them so they can reuse them. Any competition in that? No one's even trying to do what they're doing. He's also the guy that started Tesla. Any competition there? No. No one thought to produce a high-performance electric car. They wanted to produce ugly, slow electric cars. So he said, no, we're going to do it the way the customer wants. The customer is going to get what they want eventually. Right? That's the thing with the way our system works, with capitalism or free market or whatever you want to call it. Sooner or later, the customer is going to get what they want. Right? And most of you in your own businesses, you know what the customer ideally wants. Gosh, I just did it again. I lost my screen. Oh, there it goes. Thank you. And what about this? Elon Musk just announced this. Have you guys heard of this before? It's called the Powerwall. This is a battery. This is an attractive battery that you can hang in your house, and then you can put solar panels on your roof, which recharges the battery during the day so you can use it at night and disconnect from the power grid entirely. Any competition? No. All these people, right? There's many examples of these. Everything he did, he was the first one there. Right? This is all about leadership. It's about this whole conference is about leadership. Right? A lot of times we get mired in the details, and the details are important. That's why we have to hire consultants and experts, and you listen to the people who are presenting today and tomorrow, and you think about all the different technologies that are available. But at the end of the day, it's about leadership. It's about looking at your business and saying, what could we do? Right? What could we do? It's all about thinking bigger. It's So I'm very happy and grateful to be here. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much, and I'll be here for the rest of the day. So if you have questions, please find me, and I'd be happy to answer those for you. Thank you. Thank you.
Pues muchísimas gracias al señor Patrick Schwerf.